United States is we have the expertise. We can corral those people. And one of the things that we did, one of the places I work now, you've heard it mentioned, I'm the director and CEO of the Beacon Institute for Rivers and Estuaries. And Beacon Institute was founded to be a research institute about rivers and estuaries. And what we have focused on is innovation. Our mission is to create a global center for scientific and technological innovation that advances research, education, and public policy about rivers and estuaries. It sounds lovely. What does that translate into? We're creating a new generation of real-time technologies that will tell us what is going on in a river like the Hudson River, biologically, physically, and chemically, while it's happening. If we continue to innovate the technologies we're innovating, we will be able to tell you what's going to be in your drinking water glass before it ever comes out of your tap. We will be able to tell you where the fish are in the Hudson River. We will be able to tell you where the pollutants are traveling, because that information will be coming in real time through sensors that we distribute out in the river. Everybody know what sensors are? Anybody ever accidentally walk out of Barnes & Noble with a book you forgot to pay for and all the alarms go off? Or the gap with a pair of jeans? There's a sensor in the book. There's a sensor in the jeans that sets off alarms. The average car has 160 sensors in it now that run the automobile. Everything from telling you on your dashboard if your tires are deflating to controlling the cooling of your engine. That same family of technology deployed in the Hudson River will deliver to us real-time information about the physical, chemical, and biological activity in that river. It's not only about us, though. For us, the Hudson River is a laboratory. It's a laboratory for the world. Because imagine a package of those sensors in a canister deployed in a river in the developing world, communicating data by wireless technology via satellite to a central location here in New York State on water bodies where nobody will ever build a water laboratory. A laboratory in a canister that will tell us in real time what's going on in the waters all over the world. As an early warning system, as an information system about where we need to focus our attention to advance our knowledge of what's happening on the parts of the planet. Imagine further that New York State becomes the center for this, the global center for this, for the industry that will support it, for the continued innovations that will continue to make it better. When I talked early about having imagination, we don't just need imagination, we actually need a different kind of imagination. We need a 21st century imagination about where we need to go on the Hudson River and other water bodies. What we need to do about water. One thing we need is we need a new date. We need a new date. There's no sense, I mean, think about it. What's the number one water policy in the United States? As we look forward to the future, what's the number one water policy in the United States? The number one water policy in the United States as we look forward to the future is to end water pollution in 1985. Huh. That's our national policy. Our number one national policy on water is to end water pollution in 1985. I mean, come on. Now, there are government officials and lawyers who will say to me, that was an aspirational goal. It wasn't really a deadline. All right, let's say it was an aspirational goal. What does the Clean Water Act aspire to today? Does it really aspire to ending water pollution 25 years ago? We have no, the law is rudderless, it's directionless. I know folks are focusing a lot of attention on the law. There may be no more important water law on the entire planet than the United States Clean Water Act because of its global reach.
Excuse me, soft water update needs
your
attention.
That's technology. So what do? Well, one of the things we do is we set new goals for ourselves and we start talking about them. That we have the courage now to say in the 21st century what actually folks in 1965 did not say because they could not imagine it. zero pollution. They wanted to reduce pollution. They wanted to stop environmental lawbreakers. It was a great agenda, and they got in a lot of trouble for it, and they ended up having extraordinary success. Well, what do we want today for tomorrow? What we want today for tomorrow is to end pollution. Eliminate pollution, in the words of the Clean Water Act. So we need to select a new date. And anybody who talks to any candidate, who talks to any assembly person, or senator, or congressperson, I invite you to say to them, when are you going to come up with a new date for ending water pollution? The Clean Water Act said 1985. What's the new date? What's the new date? If everybody starts saying it, what's the new date? We're going to have one. But it has to be different this time.